order and design comes about from an intelligent mind. I tried to play basketball in college down in North Carolina. Balls, basketballs do not by accident go through a hoop 10 feet above the floor. I had to work so hard to get that ball to go through the hoop. All of your experience, all of my observation is, order and design demands an intelligent mind. Except you guys are saying, except one major exception. Life, the universe, the earth, that came about by chance. But everything else in my life that I observe that has order and design points to an intelligent mind. Wow, that's amazing faith. I'm sorry, I can't have that much faith. I can't. I'm too much of a skeptic to buy that line. Why? Because I don't care if it's basketball, getting an A on an exam, building a bank account, building a stock portfolio, building a relationship with my wife and children. It doesn't come together by chance. It comes together as a result of order, work, love, forgiveness, which is all very deliberate thinking on my part. That's the life I live. Now, maybe you guys live a different life. Congratulations. If you can go make the University of Arizona basketball team by just throwing the ball in the air. And lo and behold, your ball goes through the hoop. Congratulations. It doesn't work that way for me. Congratulations if you guys can build a bank account just by throwing money out the window. Doesn't work that way for me. Congratulations if you guys can build a marriage, a relationship based on, oh, I'll see you whenever, and I'll do whatever. Doesn't work that way for me, guys. Maybe it does for you, but I doubt it. I think you know exactly what I'm talking about.
What causes our consciousness and our mind, and there is no soul. How would you answer those?
I love it when people say that to me. When anybody says to me, Cliff, you got to realize you don't have a soul. You're just a highly complex biochemical reaction. I say, fine. I want to watch you live that out. And if I'm talking to a beautiful woman like you, I say, you know, the guy who said, I love you, what he really meant was, you stimulate my sex glands. If I'm talking to a guy who says, oh yeah, Cliff, she's been dating me for 5 weeks now, and she really says she loves me, but I think it's just a biochemical reaction. I say, really, how are you gonna respond tonight if your dad calls you on the phone and says, son, I've been paying her 1,000 bucks a week to love you? I think you're gonna be royally bummed out. Why? Because you know very, very well she does not have to love you. You know very, very well that part of the reason you're so excited she loves you is because she's freely choosing to love you. You see, you can't live your life based on that worldview that essentially says we're all just biochemical reactions. Because that type of determinism contradicts and violates love. And I would argue, if you don't experience love in this life, whoa, you're going to be one lonely, isolated, alienated person. Second life. Not only do I think you have the ability to love, which demands free will, I also think you can judge yourself. I think you can sit on the side of your bed tonight and you can critique what you did today. And you can say, when I said that, that was wrong. When I did that, that was right. Tomorrow, I want to do what's right and I don't want to do what's wrong. Your ability to self-reflect and to judge yourself convinces me that there's more to you than just a complex biochemical reaction. Now, when I was at MIT, the response to that was, Cliff, you don't understand. It is just the complex biochemical reaction is so complex, we just can't understand it. Okay, if you're gonna go that route, there's nothing I can say. But all I can try and point out is, you know something, That's about like saying, because I don't know something, it's God. No. For me to say, well, because I don't know something, it's God. That's not intellectually honest. And for you to come at me with this, well, I know, Cliff, I know, I do have free will. I see that from experience. But the reason that I can't believe in God is because I think that scientifically at some point we're going to be able to discover how biochemicals produce free will. Wow. That's amazing. That kind of blind faith astounds me in a Christian, and it astounds me in an atheist. I don't believe in Jesus because I have to believe. I believe in Jesus because the evidence is he lived a sinless life, the type of life I've tried to live and have failed miserably. He taught amazing ethical teachings that are the teachings of a genius. Thirdly, he died on a cross forgiving his enemies. Man, I hate my enemies usually. And fourthly, 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And my dad died in 2006. And I have a little niece that died in 1997 at the age of 7. And I can promise you, death stinks. And I'd like to find a cure for it. Jesus rose from the dead, and he said, I am the resurrection of the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. Wow. I better check this out very seriously, because death is real, and I hate death, and if there's life after death, I am certainly interested in it. Have I answered your question?
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am, for raising
it. Earlier you were talking about how God designs everything, or designed everything just like that, has a designer,
right.
The eye has a designer.
Yep.
Then, on top of that, who's God's designer if he was the one that designed
Good
us?
Good question. Excellent question. You're right. Part of my evidence for the existence of God is order and design points to an intelligent mind. And your question is excellent. Well, what about God? Who designed God? Nobody. Why? Because God is an eternal being. So my atheist friends have to acknowledge matter and energy, the universe, are eternal. There's a problem with that. It's called the Big Bang. The Big Bang theory points out, sorry, the universe is not eternal. It's about 15 billion years old, which means there was a beginning. Now here's, it's real simple. Everything that has a beginning has a cause. It's point one. Everything that has a beginning has a cause. Point two, the universe has a beginning. Point three, therefore the universe has a cause. So now the next question becomes, okay, what is the best answer to the question, who or what caused the universe? I think the answer is rather simple. An uncaused cause. You can't have an eternal regress of just keep going back and back and back, new universe, different universe, new universe, different universe. At some point, you've got a beginning. In other words, you have to have an uncaused cause. So what's the best answer to the question, who or what is the uncaused cause? An eternal God, an eternal intelligent mind, designer. Second point, is it possible to get something out of nothing? No, you never get something out of nothing. Now what an atheist is saying is, no, at one point we did get something out of nothing. No, that's impossible. The only thing that comes from nothing is nothing. You never get something coming from nothing. That is why it is far more plausible to say, in the beginning, God, than it is to say, in the beginning, nothing, and then suddenly we had something coming from nothing. Third point. According to all my observation of reality, life comes from life. Life never comes from non-life. But my atheist friend is insisting that once upon a time, way back when, life came from non-life. The animate came from the inanimate. I'm sorry, there's no evidence to support that. Oh yes, Cliff, there was an experiment in Chicago back in the 50s. Stanley Miller. Yeah, and the problem is, he put just the right chemicals together, passed an electrical charge through them, and boom, there was the beginning of life. Yeah, and NASA has shown very clearly that billions of years ago, those were not the chemicals that were made up the universal soup. So I'm sorry, the overwhelming evidence is life comes from life. My atheist friend is saying, oh no, but once upon a time, life came from non-life. I'm sorry, I can't have that much faith. I can't believe that. Because all of my observation, all of my experience is plant life comes from plant life. Animal life comes from animal life. Human life comes from human life. Never once have I seen life come from non-life by chance. Does not happen. That's why it is far more reasonable, it is far more plausible to say, in the beginning, God, rather than in the beginning, matter and energy. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for raising that issue.
Now, I don't know how much this applies, but I work with computers, and so I can write a program that can analyze how it performs on a certain task. And so, I don't know if that's relevant to what you're talking about, but...
Oh, no, it's relevant.
Okay. Since the computer can analyze itself, the computer doesn't have a soul, so how does that fit in with your explanation?
Well, I would argue that a computer is the result of you, intelligent mind, making it. I mean, if you're going to tell me that a computer gets together by accident and comes together by chance and then can spew out what a computer can spew out, I would try to politely disagree. So you see, what you're saying is, see, I never said that human beings can't create life. I think it's totally possible for us as intelligent beings to get to the point where we can create life. But what is that? That's an intelligent mind creating life. That is not life coming about as a result of chance. So I'm not going to be shocked if scientists can make life, can create life in a test tube. I mean, that's my exact point. My point is, intelligent mind, God, took matter and energy and created life. Here's an analogy that helps me. An atheist scientist goes up to God and says, I can show you that you're not necessary for creation. God says, fine, let's go through the test. The atheist says, fine, you make life and I'll make life. God says, fine. Atheist leans over, picks up a fistful of dust. And God says, wait a second, make your own dust. In other words, start with nothing. Make something. I don't care if it's dust or whatever. No, I'm sorry. We human beings can't take nothing and make something. It doesn't work that way. Nothing comes from nothing. Thanks for raising that issue. Yes, ma'am.
I think more to his point, though, is that if computers can do the exact same processes that humans can, but we want to say humans have souls, computers can't. Even though they can analyze and think and there's artificial life, what is it that makes the computer not have a soul, but the human does?
Good. You and I have a conscience. In other words, the innate ability to say that is right and that is wrong. That is good, that is evil. In other words, we are able to engage in free thinking, the free will, love, distinguishing between justice and injustice, and also we have a rational mind. So, is it more plausible for me to believe in the beginning God, or is it more plausible for me to believe in the beginning matter and energy? Now, what we as human beings can do is we can create computers, we can even get to the point, I believe, at some point of making life. But that is a result of us taking our rational minds, taking matter and energy, metal, electricity, and putting it together in such a way that it has talents. It can accomplish things. And I would argue that even if you have a machine that can do rational things, it can even possibly communicate love, that it's still a machine. And I would argue that that is qualitatively different from you and me. But because we have rational minds, we can do a lot in terms of making computers that have tremendous talent, tremendous ability. I would argue young couples who are struggling with infertility. It's amazing to watch medicine get to the point where we can really deal with infertility for a young couple, and how we can help through science, through medicine, produce a baby. So it's amazing what we can do with our rational minds, with science. But there still is something about a human being that sets us apart from a machine. And I would argue it's that free will, it's that love, it's a combination of these things, of rational thinking, of personhood, personality. But is it possible to make a computer that can do incredibly sophisticated things? Yes. Yep. And if someone wants to argue, well, that means then that we are simply highly sophisticated computers? I would say, all right, but my observation and my experience is there's more to us than just a machine. But it's obviously a hard argument, right? There are some gray areas in there for sure. There are also some gray areas in the idea that God loves us. If God really loves us, why is there so much suffering? If God really loves us, why are there birth defects? If God really loves us, then why do some people do some pretty warped things? Right? And there's obviously some mystery there. But when you look at Jesus Christ, the clear evidence is he really does love you. God really does love you. That's why he became man in Christ. That's why he bled and died on a cross, to forgive you and to give you eternal life with God. So he really does love the real you. Now, I have to decide, how am I going to respond to someone who loves me? And a Christian is someone who said, God, in light of the fact that you love me, I'm going to respond asking you for forgiveness, putting my faith in you, and trusting in you. And if you're here listening, and if this is beginning to make some sense, I would encourage you to take your own step of faith and to trust in Christ. Okay, how have I not answered your excellent question?
Well, to be honest, it's a question I'm wrestling with myself.
Yeah.
I'm in a lot of philosophy of mind courses, so we deal with a lot of these kinds of questions, and I don't know if there is really an easy answer, if it is something that can't be proven and observed and scientifically tested, and that's what, you know, a lot of the modern world wants, is they want proof, they want evidence, and I think that's where it's hard.
Great point. All right. Here's what I encourage you to do. Follow this line of thinking. The person who says to you, unless I can scientifically prove it, it's not true. Say, really? That's a self-defeating line of thought. Why? Can you scientifically prove to me that unless you can scientifically prove something, it's not true? No. You cannot scientifically prove to me that unless you can scientifically prove something, it's not true. Instead, the statement, unless I can scientifically prove it, it's not true, is a philosophy. It's a philosophy called scientism. And it basically has reduced all truth to simply that which can be proved scientifically. And I would argue that is a really bankrupt, sad philosophy. Why? Go on a scientific date. Aye, aye, aye. Try and base your family life on science. Aye, aye, aye. Try and base any friendship on science. Aye, aye, aye. You're going to be a very lonely, very isolated person. What are human relationships based on? They're based on trust. Now, hopefully you don't trust a criminal. Hopefully you don't trust a liar. Hopefully you don't trust a cheater. Hopefully the evidence is that the person you trust is a person of integrity, honesty, compassion. Not that they're perfect, but that that is their goal, their desire. And then you trust that person. That's how you have relationships. And for someone to try and reduce trusting a person to a scientific equation is really, really sad. Scientifically prove to me that George Washington was the first president of the United States. You can't do that. Our knowledge that George Washington was the first president of the United States is based on historical knowledge. Scientific knowledge is based on the repeatability of an experiment. You don't get George Washington back every fall here at the University of Arizona and have him be inaugurated. No. People saw Washington inaugurated. They wrote it down. And guess what? The University of Arizona charges a lot of money for you guys to take history courses. Why? Because historical knowledge, although it's different from scientific knowledge, is a legitimate form of knowledge. Historical knowledge. See, so the person who says, unless you can scientifically prove it, it's not true, has blind faith in a philosophy that says all of truth can be reduced to science. That is a very narrow-minded view of reality. Science is beautiful. It's an awesome field of study. But so is history. So is learning to trust someone and developing a friendship. So is developing a family and learning to love each other. Crucial part of knowing and experiencing life. And that's what a follower of Christ is. A follower of Christ is someone who says, yes, science is good, and I will do the best science I can. But guess what? The ultimate purpose of life is not to do science. The ultimate purpose of life is to love God and to love people, just the way Jesus said. We are relational beings.
Raising children is a fascinating proposition. What a challenge. Do you realize, as a mom and a dad, that you have the privilege of sensitizing a human being's conscience as you raise your child? God has created all of us human beings and given us a conscience, this innate ability to distinguish between right and wrong, good and evil. But a big part of the development of the human conscience has to do with a parent's influence, a parent's training. The desensitization of the human conscience is scary, and it is being done by the media in the proliferation of violent movies, pictures, and sexually immoral movies and pictures. The desensitization of the human conscience is something that was studied immediately following World War II. A group of social scientists wanted to study the Nazis who had been commissioned and placed into bands of 12 to 20 men and go through Eastern Europe, slaughtering men, women, and children at random. They succeeded, these bands of 12 to 20 Nazi soldiers, in slaughtering approximately 1.4 million people. The social scientists who interviewed these Nazis were convinced that these people were deranged individuals. Quite to the contrary, what they discovered after interviewing these Nazi soldiers was that they were very normal people. They were doctors, lawyers, business people, and shopkeepers. But they had been trained by their superiors. Their consciences had been desensitized. One of the ways their trainers did that was to give each one of them a little German Shepherd puppy. These Nazi soldiers were to cuddle with their puppy, bond with them, and then they were forced to break the puppy's neck with their own bare hands. That was part of the process of desensitizing their consciences to get them to the point where they could wantonly murder men, women, and children throughout Eastern Europe. One of the reasons that you and I need Jesus Christ is because He puts His Holy Spirit in us when we put our faith in Him. And the Holy Spirit is the one who can sensitize our consciences. But He uses us as moms and dads to begin that process and to continue that process in our children. What a challenge. The competition is intense. In fact, when you and I put our faith in Christ, our lives are not based on being number one, competition, and beating others out. But we are in competition. And the most intense competition we're in is the competition against evil, against injustice, against the desensitizing of the human conscience that is rampant around us. What a privilege it is to teach our children that at the center of the cosmos is a God who loves, a God who is just, a God who is good, morally pure, a God in whose character is not a trace of evil or selfishness. Then to know this God, to respond to this God, by putting one's faith in Jesus Christ and then allowing God's Holy Spirit to change you from the inside out, to change your heart. That is crucial. Jesus says in Mark 7, 21-23, "For from within, out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts, fornication, theft, murder, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, wickedness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a man." That is why it is so important to point our children to Jesus Christ, to teach them about Him, to encourage them to make their own free decision, to trust in Him, and then to allow His Spirit to sensitize their conscience so that they are able, as growing children, as young adults, and then as mature adults, to distinguish between good and evil, right and wrong. What a high calling. What a high privilege to be a mom, to be a dad, who grows your child's conscience in a way that honors God, in a way that respects and loves people. God bless you as you put your faith in Christ and then encourage your children to put their faith in Christ and to grow sensitive consciences. I'm the pastor of Grace Community Church. We meet every Sunday morning at 9:30 at Sachs Middle School in New Canaan, Connecticut. Simply take the Merritt Parkway to exit 37, go to the end of the ramp, take a left onto Route 124, go approximately 1 mile and take a right into Sachs Middle School. I'd love to personally invite you to join us this Sunday, 9:30, Sachs Middle School, New Canaan, Connecticut. Thanks for joining us for these few minutes. Have a great day.